celebrate Jesus. Can you help me put your hand together? the blood of Jesus.
Thank you. Thank you. Son. Hallelujah. We worship you. Come on, give him some praise. Hallelujah, Lord God. Oh, no grave could hold you. We so thank you for your life here tonight. Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's pray for our leaders. The fellowship leaders in Prescott, Arizona, Pastor Greg and Lisa Mitchell. Let's lift up Jesse and Bethany Morales and Diego Kelly Galvan and Stephen and Emily Cassio. Let's remember to also pray for Pastor Paul Linda Campo, getting ready for the conference, Pastor Chip and Lori Ganier. Let's lift up the Suspanskys and the Kings in Jacksonville, North Carolina. And can we pray for my pastor, Keith and Carrie Sullivan, and all their converts and what God is doing in East Rochester, help them to find a building, help them to find the will of God. Anoint our pastor this evening as he's preaching. There are many visitors. Let's pray for, amen, converts to be made, amen. Let's also pray for the Greece church, amen, converts to lock in, amen. We're seeing a lot of people coming to church. But we need people to lock in. We need a miracle. Amen. That takes a miracle. I know it's a miracle when they walk through that door. Amen. But it's also a miracle when they repent of their sins and when they finally get it and start coming. Amen. On a faithful basis. That is when you know that somebody's getting it. Amen. Out of duty. Not just out of emotion, but out of a sense that Jesus has done something miraculous in their life. Amen. Let's pray for Greece Church, impact in the neighborhoods, and impact with our outreaches in the mall and at Walmart and in the streets and the neighborhoods in the upcoming months. Let's pray for God to do things, supernatural things that are way beyond us, instead of us being an organization and trying to get people to join. It's not about that. It's about miracles to occur. We're going to pray continually for these children. Evelyn and Aubrey have a horrific sickness and disease. We're going to pray for some of the fruit. Let's pray for Bob and Mark. They came to the music night that we had. And let's also pray for, amen, Clive and his girlfriend, amen, Rob Ralph, amen, and Natalie Lopez in the hospital, Dan and Stacy, miracles to that family, Joe and Angela recovering from cancer, a young man named Jacob, and all that God is doing, hallelujah. I'm excited about what God is doing. Let's pray for the conference announcements, and that was at the last conference we had couples that were launched overseas. Let's continue to pray for the Kenyans in Cambodia. We sent a couple into Lima, Peru, another one to Vietnam, Mexico, and St. Lucia. These are the islands. Amen. And there were 16 workers, brand new churches sent out for the last conference. Let's pray that they have success. Amen. That they hit the ground running and, amen, jobs and a place to live and a place to meet for their brand new church. Amen. Miracles to occur. Hallelujah. Perhaps there's a need that you have in your life. Amen. A loved one that's not saved. Maybe you're sick in your body. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand up, and we're going to pray with you. If you have someone that has a need, amen, God sees your hand. Maybe you have a loved one, a brother or a sister that are not saved. Amen. And you know what? They're on their way to hell. And that should concern you. That should be at the top of your prayer list. Amen. People that are sick, of course, people that are dying, amen, but also people in Greece, amen, that need a miracle. They need to be born again, amen, and we're going to get ready, get our hearts ready, amen, so when we partake of the communion, we have the bread and the grape juice on Sunday, amen, that our hearts are right, amen, and that we can have a heart like Jesus, amen, and we can love people. Let's pray together. Can I ask David to open us up in prayer when we subside? Let's pray for God to have his way tonight. God, we want you to have your way.
We pray for our loved ones that are backslidden, God, all our children, our parents, God, that do not know you, Lord God, and I know and believe that you're coming back soon, God, and quickly. And God, hundreds and thousands of people, God, in Greece, New York, and Rochester, in the metro area, God, that need salvation, God. They need to be washed in your blood. They need a miracle in their spirits, addictions broken, alcohol and drugs and immorality, Lord God, bring joy and life to the dead souls that Satan has stolen right now. We commend you. We allow you to have right of way here tonight. God, anoint this service with the Holy Ghost. And God, give us a passion to see your will accomplished in our time and our watch, God. We don't want to play religion, God, but we want you to have a right of way tonight, Lord God, in our lives this week. And bring people to church on Sunday, God, for a glorious service, a glorious remembrance of what you've done, God. I'm asking in Jesus' wonderful name, Lord God.
Open our eyes and see the people around us that are leaning toward you, so that we can see those that are ready to be harvested and help them come in, Lord. Give us the grace to be helpful. Give us the grace to be anointed, Lord, so that these people around here who are going to turn to you do, Lord, so that we can get them harvested, so that they can get solid with you, come to know you in a real way, be reborn, have their lives be changed, Lord.
Yes, amen. Let's give the Lord praise. Lord, we thank you, God, for this night. God, what can we do? God, we commend this service to you. Amen. Let's take a moment to greet one another and make everybody feel welcome. Those online, we want to thank you for joining us. May the Lord bless you. Hey, y'all. Hey, Moesha.
I was there the moment that it happened, but you couldn't see me through the pain. I caught every tear as they were falling when you lost your heart that day. Yeah, you lost your heart that day. Now you only see through broken lenses, trying to keep your head above the shame. You believe the lie that I am distant, but I hold you every day. Yeah, I hold you every day. If you could see it through my eyes,
for outreach. You know the drill. And this Sunday at 10 o'clock, we're going to have our adult Sunday school. And 10:30 is our Easter service. You don't want to miss that. Amen. If you're listening live, you know that you folks that are here this evening, amen, that you're going to be there on Sunday morning. But let's make a good show of it. Amen. If you've never come to church, I'm going to challenge you to start coming to church now. Amen. COVID is going away. Amen. We're seeing the numbers going way down. And I mean, if you're comfortable with the mask, that's fine. But we're going to challenge you to get into church. Amen. And why not start on Resurrection Day this Sunday at 10:30? Hallelujah. We'll be here waiting for you. I'm going to save you one of these comfortable blue chairs here. I know that you're going to have a great time. God's going to help you. Hallelujah. Sunday evening, we have another service at 6:30. 5:30 is prayer. Amen. If you have any questions about the upcoming conference called the Days of Awakening, amen, that will be in April. And we will be fasting a week from Monday, amen, for 3 days. If you'd like to join us or if you have any questions about that, amen. Let's change the order of the service and take our offering. This is called Come Into the Land. And I want you to think about this. I'm reading this scripture that we need to recognize that your success is because of God. And when He blesses you, remember that I told you this. And be thankful, amen. And that means, amen, giving an offering to God that will reveal your heart. You're healthy. You've got success on your job. Your family's pretty cohesive. God's working miracles through you, amen. Don't ever forget that. And let there be an expression in your heart of giving. Can I ask the usher to come? Numbers 15, 1 through 3. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, when you come into the land that you are about to inhabit, which I am giving you, and you make an offering by fire to the Lord, a burnt offering or a sacrifice to fulfill a vow or a freewill offering or your appointed feasts to make a sweet aroma to the Lord from the herd or from the flock. Amen. Don't forget what God has done for you. Amen. And be faithful with your tithes and offerings besides.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord. We are grateful that you've taken care of us and you have for years and years.
Yes.
And years, Lord. We thank you, Lord. You are absolutely trustworthy. That's what faith is believing that you're trustworthy. We have found through experience that you are that. And we praise you for that, Jesus. Take our offering.
Amen. God bless you. You can click the link if you want to offer something in life. Anytime you want to sing about the blood, count me in. Amen. If you'd like to turn your Bibles, we're going to be in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27 in a quick moment. I like the way this was written here, so that's why we're going to use it as our opening statement. You guys know the story of Lazarus and the rich man. Okay, so put your mind around that right now. And this is not the Lazarus that was risen from the dead. This is the one who was a beggar and he was outside of the rich man's castle, let's say. And he was begging. The dogs licked his sores. You know the picture. They both died. And instantaneously, they're both in eternity. So here's this story. Some of you might be familiar with it. The rich man said, God, why don't you please, I beg you, send someone to my brothers to warn them about this place. So here goes. Imagine Lazarus. Suddenly, he appears in the hall where the five brothers of the rich man's funeral was being held. And their hypocritical grief for him, they've forgotten him already. They're sitting there. And they're arrayed in purple and fine linen, faring sumptuously. And some other beggar is now at the gates, and his sores are being licked by the same dogs. So you can see on their faces, blanched or gone white. And they're just like blown away as Lazarus comes back from the dead to tell them about eternity. Their glasses fall from their nerveless grasp. They drop their glasses and shatter on the pavement. And Lazarus says to them, "Your brother is in hell. He has sent me to warn you and to tell you to repent." Such a visitation, such an apparition, you think, would break down the wall of any man's heart and bring prompt and full repentance. But he who knows the hearts to its depths said, "No, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they listen or be persuaded, though one rose from the dead." Luke 16:31. So, for the rich man, repentance was never experienced. Amen. And he wound up going to hell for judgment. And Lazarus was in Abraham's bosom. He was enjoying eternity. Amen. The rich man never changed his life. I'm not saying rich people are evil, but it is difficult to live for God if you've got a lot of money, or if everything's fine, you see no need for me to change. Everything's good. I'm set. People say that to you all the time. He never took the time to examine himself and to really look deep inside. Let's look at our need to obey Scripture tonight, and our need to obey the Holy Ghost when he convicts us and starts talking to us and starts dealing with us. No, you're not crazy. And you're hearing voices. No, that could be God showing you what you need to do with your life. Amen. And I'm preaching this sermon in preparation for all those who are planning on taking the Lord's communion, as they say. We're going to be breaking bread and drinking the cup of grape juice on Sunday. But first we need to examine our hearts. Amen. 1 Corinthians 11:27. "Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of our Lord." So this is a serious thing we need to do. We need to examine, judge, and then we can partake in preparation for Easter. Amen. We're going to be soon, in a few days, celebrating the body and the blood of Jesus. Amen. In a sermon I've entitled, "Examine Yourself." Amen. Hallelujah. Let's first look at our need to examine. Verse 28, "But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup." Some of you might not know what we're talking about. Let me just refer to the day that Jesus was about to be turned over to the authorities, and he was having his last supper. Many of you might have seen the Da Vinci painting of it, right? And they're all lined up there, and the lowest head, you know who that is, that's Judas. And some of you are familiar with the painting, but that is in a remembrance of the Last Supper, where Jesus was saying his goodbyes. And I believe that was a time when they were washing feet. It was a whole event that was when Jesus was about to depart. Amen. And he took the bread and he broke it before them. He said, "This is my body. It's about to be broken." And he was predicting or prophesying about what was about to happen to him. And this grape juice that we're drinking, this is the blood of the covenant. "And I want you to remember me, remember my sacrifice," amen, "through the breaking of bread and through the drinking of the grape juice. When you do this, you remember. You're doing this in remembrance of me." And so he was foretelling that so that we would do this as a remembrance of what he did. So some people, some churches do this all the time. They do it every service. And We do it once a year. That's been our tradition. And so we're going to be doing that on Sunday. So we need to examine or to look inside our hearts to see if we're in the right state of mind. Usually when you look inside your heart, it's pretty filthy. Can anybody say amen? There are sins that you've committed that you're so ashamed that you did that. Whether it's you did drugs or you mocked some people out or you did some horrendous crime. Maybe you've murdered somebody. Maybe you've raped somebody. And you see the sins that you've committed. But there's also sins that have been omitted. You were supposed to do things for people. You were supposed to bless people. And you said, no, I'm not doing it. You were supposed to help somebody. You said, no, I'm not doing it. You omitted them. And so for you and I, the real Christian is the one whose conscience is pricked very easily. Like, oh, I'm sorry. I hope I didn't come off the wrong way. You're careful about your relationships. You want to make sure that, amen, you're right with God, because you and I believe that Jesus is coming back also. We want to be right. We want to be ready. We want to be pleasing to God. We don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit. And so for the Christian in here, amen, we need to look at our hearts and examine our motives. Why we do things. Are they pure? Or are they impure? Why are you saying that? Why are you doing that? And we have resentments. There's all kinds of ungodly sentiments that we have working inside of us. Even the most saved among us, the most spiritual, there is still, amen, things that we need to look at and examine. It's not just a quick glance. You're looking across the parking lot, you see the seagulls, and then they fly away. No, this is something examining. You're looking at it. You are inspecting or deeply in detail looking to determine the nature or the condition of an issue. It's to investigate something thoroughly. Amen. So this can be very painful if you're going to be honest. Amen. You can make believe that you're religious. You can make believe that everything's fine if you want to and be in denial of the serious nature that is before you. Amen. You can do that if you want to, but you will not be partaking of the Lord's Supper. Amen. As we're about to do that, because you'll be taking it, but you will bring a condemnation upon yourself. You'll be in deep trouble with God, man, and I wouldn't want to be around you, because God does not like this, eating in an unworthy and drinking in an unworthy manner. So we need to take an inventory of what's going inside of us, what we're thinking about. It's pretty grueling if we're going to be honest with ourselves. Amen. This may be an uncomfortable sermon, but I want you to know it's kind of like surgery. You can do it on your own if you want to. You can do it tonight after the service. You can do it right now as we're talking. Amen. Or you can do it, amen, before Sunday. Take an inventory. This means looking at what is in stock in the storehouse of your heart or your mind. It's the picture of going down to Walmart and you see the shelves, and somebody has to go through there, straighten them out, count them. Or you're at Lowe's. We're looking for some switches today, and the bay is empty. Somebody's not doing their job. They're not taking the inventory. They're not replenishing. They're not aware of the fact that they're missing the boxes of switches that we needed, because somebody's not taking inventory and they're not ordering it and so on and so forth. You get the idea. Counting the number of times that we have fallen can be very depressing if we're going to take an inventory and see how our hearts are. Realizing, thirdly, what is cluttering up the shelves of storage deep within your heart. Amen. What is in there is scary. Amen. Thinking, fourthly, about what we are thinking about. You have to take knowledge of what's going on inside of you, amen. If you want to be real with God, if you want to be saved, you're going to have to be honest, because the Holy Spirit is going to deal with you from time to time where you're lacking, what you're doing wrong, amen. He's going to have to deal with you once in a while about certain things, amen. And if you'll be honest, amen, God's going to help you. God's going to give you the breakthrough that you need, amen. God is going to prepare you for that supper we're about to celebrate on Sunday, amen. Fifthly, determining which habits that you're engaging in are beneficial to your relationship with Jesus. If you're messing around on the internet, if you're living immoral, or if you're you're dabbling in these different things, or you're getting off track from God, amen, that's going to put a block or something in between you and Jesus, amen. You do not want this to happen. Don't let anything come in between you and God. Amen. The second thing in the examination process is prayer. Taking inventory is thinking about what you're thinking about, of course, but when we pray and we're connecting with God in a supernatural dimension, and what I mean by that is we're actually talking to God and we're allowing Him to talk back to us. It's a communication. God, what am I doing wrong? You're being sincere, like you're searching, amen, asking those hard questions. Are there any blind spots that I do not see? Show me, amen. And I'm reminded of David. David said, reveal to me my hidden faults. David wanted to be clean. He wanted to be pure. He wanted to be holy. He wanted to have a heart after God. And so you can read the Psalms and find out, amen, that he was deeply searching for that relationship, wanting to be right with God in all areas. Yeah. Amen. God, help me to deal, fourthly, with the most serious issues first. Amen. If there's blatant sin in your life, amen, you need to stop doing it. Stop! Cut it out of your life and see the virtue of being delivered of that demon spirit or whatever you're going through, amen, and separating yourself from that and repenting. If it's sin, cut it out and get it done. Be healed, man. Move up, move on. And this is going to be dangerous, amen, if you let that happen. And other things, amen, that are to be taken care of are things that could get in between you and Jesus. Amen. You want to find out, God, is this good? Do you want me to do this? You have to be in prayer seeking God. And thirdly, as you're examining yourself, amen, our need is to get real with God. This will help you to avoid becoming religious. Amen. The last thing on earth is to become a religious bum. Yeah. Amen. Because it will just lock God out of your life. You'll be just playing games. You're kind of hypocritical. You're like an actor on stage. You're just making believe that, you know, you believe. But really, you know, you're just, it's like a show. You're religious. This is very dangerous. And that will keep you out of God's will and out of God's blessing. You need to be conscious of what you're thinking about, what you're doing. And from time to time, let him do surgery in your heart. Amen. That means let him break out with the scalpel. He's a crafty, he's a surgeon, he's a delicate, he's a doctor that knows exactly what to cut, where to make the laceration. Now they have laser surgery, and you know, they do a lot of miraculous kind of things with laser beams and so on. And I want you to know that when, from time to time, God's going to try to get a hold of you. Amen. If you're perfect in here, man, then you could probably walk on water. Or you could turn this guitar into a drum set. If you're God, amen, if you're perfect, then that's what I'm saying. We have to be conscious as we're examining ourselves so that we're right with God. Get rid of that cancer. Let God cut it out as soon as possible, or it will start eating away at other parts of your mind, away from your life. Become conscious of how you are treating other people. This is where the rubber meets the road, my friend. We're in relationship with people. So how are we treating those in our lives? Are you conscious about the way you're talking to people? Are you talking down to people? Are you treating them like trash? Are you disrespecting them? Amen. Be aware of your relationship with Jesus. Can you hear his voice? Is he talking to you right now, perhaps? Or you have a song going on in your head? Are you obeying him? I call you friends, he said, if you do whatever I command you. And he commands us to love our enemies. Amen. Forgiving other people's offenses. Thirdly, learning how to be sensitive to his leading. Amen. It might not even be anything sinful that you're involved in. What you're doing may be the sin of omission, as I spoke a little earlier, not doing something that he wants you to do. He wants us to be flexible, moldable, and yielding to others sometimes, putting others before us. Amen. So if we decide to eat the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, this is a religious manner. This is when we find ourselves out of God's will. The problem is compounded when we're ignoring the Holy Ghost and we're digging our heels in. I ain't going to change. I ain't doing it. Even worse, we decide to take the bread and juice and we say we're Christian. We're celebrating the Lord's death and resurrection and we're making a mockery of it. That's the danger of it. Active rebellion. That's the unworthy manner. It might be out and out sin that we're involved in. Maybe you're talking heresies or false doctrines. Maybe you're doing drugs, alcohol, immorality. Fill in the blank. But disobeying God's direct intervention puts you in a fighting stance. You are against God. You're in rebellion to him. Amen. And this is an unworthy manner. Secondly, it may be disobedience. What's dangerous is being out of God's will and leading people away from him. This is the whole idea and responsibility for you and I, that we are called to be examples of what it's like to be a Christian. And so if our example is carnal, or if we look like somebody in the world, like a regular person, then we're going to be sending a confusing message. Amen. I thought Christians weren't supposed to do that. And people can see your life, amen, and you're misleading them. This is disobedient because God wants you to act a certain way, amen. They are watching your life, and they become confused to what it is to be a God-fearing Christian. Look at Luke 6:46 with me for a minute. But why do you call me Lord, Lord, Jesus says, and do not the things that I say? Whoever comes to me and hears my sayings and does them, I will show you who he is like. He's like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when the floods arose, the stream beat vehemently against that house and could not shake it, for it was founded on the rock. So there's an enduring quality to a Christian's life. They're not going to be wavering. They're not going to be all over the place. I mean, they're not going to be disobedient. And thirdly, there's undisclosed sin, which means that you are not confessing that. The confession of your sin is part of a process for you to get saved. Amen. For you to get whole. And then when you admit it, man, and then you confess it with your mouth, Scripture teaches us that he who covers his sin will not prosper. Amen. You're not being honest. You're not being forthcoming. Amen. Proverbs 28:13. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. And David tried to cover it up when he was in adultery with Bathsheba, and then he murdered her husband. And then he lied about the whole thing. Amen. And the Bible says that your sin will find you out. Nathan showed up, gave him the parable of the sheep, the little lambie. And he said, you are the man. David could have repented at any time through this process, and it would have gotten a lot better, a lot quicker. But he tried to hide. He tried to cover it up. Your sin finds you out. Amen. Some men's sins go before them and others follow after. And David wrote in Psalms, he said, my bones felt like they were dried up. There was really no joy in David's life as he was trying to cover up his sin and make believe it never happened. Amen. Thirdly, the worthy kind of a manner that we are allowed to be in is to be a repentant manner. In other words, to take the Lord's Supper on Sunday morning, and then that is a worthy manner. To take it as you're agreeing with God, we could sense the dealing of the Holy Ghost. Then it will be best to consider our ways before God judges us. Jesus said that there's two kinds of people. One is they let the rock fall on them because they're not going to repent, they're not going to change, and it destroys them. It just shatters them. And then there's the person that falls on the rock. That's the person you want to be, where you, amen, can avoid the judgment and judge your sin yourself and do it before, amen, it's too late. Eating the Lord's Supper with a right heart means that you're surrendered to God. You want to do what he wants to do. If he's been dealing with you about something, do it before Sunday. Amen. Confess with your lips. Amen. That means believing in your mind and understanding what is right, and then confessing, making that confession, saying, you know what, God, you're right. This is my problem. I am sorry for that. How I couldn't see it for so long. Please forgive me. He'll forgive you, but you've got to confess it. You've got to admit that you have fallen in some area. And then release it to God. Confess with your lips. Amen. You will immediately be forgiven. There's no time delay in God. When you catch it, you get the revelation, you say, oh man, that's what I've been missing all this time. I am sorry for this. And God will help you to repent, and then you can move on. And you will become worthy to partake in the Lord's Supper. Now your heart is complete before God. You're not making a joke of the Lord's Supper. You're not making a joke of his crucifixion. You're not faking your faith. Amen. You're setting your heart up in a worthy manner to partake. Amen. Amen. You can repent. The repentant mind has become convicted. That means you're guilty. You realize that. The Bible says that we're all guilty before God. Amen. But you have received that healing through your repentance. You're changing your mind. You heard God's voice. You're not going to harden your heart as you normally do and say, no, you're talking about somebody else, preacher. It's not me. You have a hardened heart. You don't want to agree with what God is saying to you. You need to let your heart become soft and moldable as clay. God will give you a new heart. That word metanoia is the Greek word for repentance. It means the mind after, when God deals with you about something. Amen. Your heart, as you're changing your mind, becomes healed. You have a repentant heart. It becomes complete. Amen. This is the worthy manner that we can have for taking the bread and the juice. Here in the celebrating of Resurrection Day, Jesus from the dead. Let's talk quickly about the promise. Amen. That is to judge yourself. Amen. My second point for those taking notes. You have to judge yourself. Amen. When you judge yourself, you can avoid God's judgment. Amen. Matthew 21:44. Whoever falls on this stone will be broken. Whoever it falls on, it will grind him to powder. Falling on God's mercy is the action we need to take to get right with God. Moving toward God, not running away from him all the time. God's trying to corner you. He's trying to get you to change. He's trying to help you. He wants to bring blessing into your life. But you have to deal with the issues. You can't just keep running away from God. You come to church for a short time and you're doing good. And then God wants to bring you to the next level. And you say, nope, that ain't happening. And then you start skipping church. And then pretty soon you're backslidden. You're gone. Just gone. You're avoiding the opportunity to repent. Running away from God. His voice is trying to speak to you. Amen. Because the wages of sin is death. He wants to heal you and avoid that. And he wants to remind you that the free gift of God is eternal life. Forgiveness is promised to those. Amen. You can avoid the judgment, God judging you, and letting that rebellion or whatever you're involved in work out to its fullest extent and then lose everything, my friend. You don't want that to happen. And if you judge yourself first, come clean. Let's look at the cross. Amen. Where the judgment of your sin was paid for by Jesus. Without the shedding of blood, amen. The Bible teaches there's no forgiveness of sin. Amen. You can try to be good, but all your good works are vanity. They're foolishness. It gives you the right to brag. It gives you bragging rights. Amen. And that is very evil. I want you to realize that when Jesus said, "It is finished," he meant the power of sin over mankind and over your life. He said, he's hanging on the cross there for you. He realizes what he's doing. He says, "It is finished." Praise God. The spilled blood of the perfect sacrifice has become a payment. Amen. God pulled out his wallet and he paid for your soul completely in full so you could be free from your slavery. He gave everything. The highest cost, his own son. Amen. Now man has been reconciled to God. All those who call upon his name shall be saved. We are free from sin, and that curse of sin is now broken. And we are at one with God. We have peace with God. Amen. To as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the children of God. We're now overcomers as he overcame the world. We are more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. Amen. Revelation 12:11, and they overcame the devil by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. This is our hope. They did not love their lives to the end, to the death. We are more than conquerors. Romans 8:37, yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers, anything present or things to come, nor height nor depth nor anything created shall be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. This is what that spilled blood has given you and I. And so let's think lastly about partaking. My third point. We can enjoy the remembrance. The remembrance. And then verse 30. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. The writer of Romans is teaching us that some, when they take the body and the grape juice and they do it, the remembrance of Jesus' sacrifice, they do it in an unworthy manner, that many bad things can happen. Amen. People get sick. Amen. They're weak. Many die even because the church was not being, was not doing it the right way. Many people were eating and they didn't care. Yeah, everybody come on in and take the bread. It's okay. Don't worry about it. You can still be living in sin. You can still be immoral. You can still, have a mistress. You can still be doing things that are immoral, illegal, and just unrighteous. Go ahead. You can do it. So they had a lot of problems because of this. And the writer of Romans is talking about our need to pay attention and respect it. And when we do it God's way in a worthy manner, blessings begin to flow. There will be strength that is added, amen, in the assembly. We're not going to just play church. We're not just going to be religious. But we're going to have a strength. There will be people that will be added to this church. Pillars will come. Amen. Miracles will occur. God will encourage you to keep fighting for what is right. And he will help you to finish well. He wants to strengthen you. Some of you in this place are weak. You want to give up. You're tired of praying. You're tired of fighting, or you're tired of outreaching. You're tired of living as a Christian. Amen. God wants to strengthen you. And when you do this the right way, amen, God will strengthen you and help you. Secondly, he'll keep our bodies healthy. Amen. Many people were getting sick because they thought this was a joke. And if we are sick or diseased, we have the power, amen, because we're going to do it the Bible way. We're going to do it God's way, his prescription, amen. And now we are alive in Christ. Amen. People were dying. People, it says here they were sleeping, but what that means is that people were dying because they were not honoring God the right way. We're now, thankfully, we're alive in Christ. We're dead to sin. We're dead to the world, and we're dead to that old man. We don't have to live that way anymore. We're alive in Christ. We can receive the benefits of what Jesus has accomplished. Amen. And the benefits of the cross and the resurrection. We have eternal life. Never forget where you came from and never forget what God has done. Let's do it his way. Let's partake on Sunday with a right heart. You have 3 days. You can confess your sins. You can pray with somebody if you want to. You can pray by yourself. But get it right before that day when you come to eat the bread and drink the juice. Amen. Let me close with this. He knows what is best. A Persian legend runs that a certain king needed a faithful servant, and two men were candidates for the office. He took both at fixed wages, and first order was to fill a basket with water from a neighboring well, saying that he would come in the evening and see their work. After putting in one or two bucketfuls of water, one man said, "What's the good of doing this useless work? As soon as we put water in one side, it runs out the other." The other answered, "But we have our wages, haven't we? The use is the master's business, not ours. I am not going to do such fool's work, replied the other. Throwing his bucket down, he went away. The other man continued until he had exhausted the well. There's nothing left in there. Throwing down his bucket, he went away. The other man continued until he had exhausted the well. Looking down into it, he saw something shining. A diamond ring. Now I see the use of pouring the water in a basket, he cried. If the bucket had brought up the ring before the well was emptied, it would have been found in the basket. Our work was not useless. So Christians must believe that their master knows what is best and obey his commands. And in due time, they will know and they will understand. Amen. Let's obey our Savior, our Master, and do it His way. Amen. And watch what God can do in this church and in your life. Amen. Examine yourself. Let's close our eyes and bow our heads. Amen. And with no one moving around, let's give an opportunity to, amen, those who are listening online, or maybe you're sitting here in the congregation and you're not saved. Amen. You have never repented of your sins. You've never given your life to God. You have been living in sin for such a time now, but God has a plan to save you from your sin. It's called the cross. Jesus was set up, they lied about him, and he was beaten before the Sanhedrin and before Pilate, and they scourged him with a whip, they put a crown on him, they laughed him, they called him king. But he went to the cross and subjected himself to that pain and suffering for your soul, that your sins could be forgiven. Amen. How many would there be? You know that you're a sinner and there's sin in your life, but you want to be forgiven. God is here right now. Hallelujah. His presence is available to you. He wants to show his love. Because you know what? He died for you and he shed his blood to pay the price for your sins. Amen. I want to pray with you if you're not saved and you can have your sins taken off of you. You can be forgiven tonight. How many would there be? You're not saved. With an uplifted hand, you need me to pray with you. Amen. From the front to the back, left to the right. Amen. Maybe you're listening online. You're not saved. God loves you. And if you'll confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, amen, and give your heart to him, you can be forgiven. Or if you're backslidden, amen, maybe you're not right with God. I would like to pray with you right now. If you're listening online, amen, close your eyes and repeat this prayer and believe in your heart that God died for you. And God will give you a miracle. The Bible promises you'll be born again and your old life will go away. You'll break the habits. You'll break the addictions. You'll see your life in a brand new light. Why don't you pray with me? Say, Jesus, I'm sorry for my sin. And I thank you for dying on the cross. I thank you for the blood that you shed. I thank you for everlasting life. I repent of my bad choices and all the evil things that I've been thinking. And I change my life because of your love. Thank you for this night. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer online and you meant it, I believe you meant it, and I believe that God has a plan for your life. Amen. Contact us. Let us know how we can help you. If you want to come to church, we're located in Greece, New York, at Stone and Ridge in the old Toys R Us Plaza. Amen. God is saving people. God has a plan for your life. He wants to share his love with you. He wants you to grow as a Christian, become discipled, and watch things, miraculous things begin to happen in your life. Amen. This is for the Christian. Amen. Getting right with God is where it's at, man. Examine yourself. Think about what you're thinking about and get right. Amen. We're going to open up the altars and sing this song with our sister. You can come now and talk to God if you like. Amen. God, I want to thank everybody for attending our midweek service. Amen. Looking forward to this weekend and all that God's going to accomplish. And let's believe God. Amen. Brother David, can you pray for us, please?
Yeah, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Sitting here remembering what you did for us and what we all did Friday.
Wish I
could. Certainly wasn't good for you. And we thank you that you were willing to do what was necessary so
yep.
that we could be redeemed. Thank you, Jesus, that you are the worthy sacrificial lamb. We praise you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you for coming. Your faithfulness. The Lord bless you. Have a great week.
Did you see that thing in the link that I sent you?
No, I didn't get to look.
That's crazy. Yeah, I don't know.
I was there the moment that it happened. But you couldn't see me through the pain. I caught every tear as they were falling when you lost your heart that day.